We have some work to do here. Well, you're in luck because it's the Sabbath, and we're not supposed to work on the Sabbath. But this isn't really work. What we're going to do is help the grown-ups. Do you think we can do that? No?
Apparently there's no hope.
It's too hard. They're beyond our help, huh? Well, we can try anyway. So last week we started to talk about Sabbath. And only a couple of you were here, I think. So do we know what Sabbath is? Anybody have a guess what that word means?
A day.
What?
A day.
It is a day, but it's a special kind of day. What do we do on a Sabbath day?
Do nothing.
Do nothing, kind of. Well, we can't just stay on our couch and watch TV.
Why not?
We'll get to that. But here's what we can do. There's three C's of Sabbath. So last week we learned Sabbath is a gift from God. It's a day where we rest from work, as it meaning the things we feel like we have to do. But sometimes we do things that kind of look like work, but they are really good for our souls. One example I always think of is like gardening. That's a lot of work for me. But my mom loves to garden. It makes her soul happy. So it just depends on the person what counts as work and what counts as a healthy Sabbath activity. So what, Teddy?
What happens if your soul runs away?
If your soul runs away? Oh man. I don't think you need to worry about that. Because if it runs away, it's gonna go back to who made it, and then you'll be alright.
God made it.
Exactly. So what do you think the three C's of Sabbath might be? Three things we can do on the Sabbath that begin with C.
Candy.
Of course, Cassidy. Color, that's a good one. What do you think?
Cranberries.
Okay, well, here, these are our categories. There's three things. We're gonna cease. Do you know what that means?
Meaning.
Not seize. That's a different word. Cease means to take. Cease means to stop. Quit it. Cease and desist means stop. Get out of here. And then we're also going to celebrate. Yeah, celebrating isn't work, is it?
Yeah,
so we have to set up. So we have to set up before the Sabbath. So we do our work so that we can just celebrate. And then we're going to connect. Connect four. That's a good Sabbath activity, for sure. Playing games with other people because it helps you connect with them. So what are some things we should cease, we should stop doing on the Sabbath?
Laundry.
That's a good one. Unless you love doing laundry and it makes your joy happy. Your soul happy. What can we cease?
Staying awake.
Laundry and staying awake. That might be what your soul really needs, is a nap. That's okay. Cleaning. Yeah, cease the cleaning. Basically, anything you feel like you have to do. Anything you think, this needs to get done. Well, don't do it on a Sunday, or whatever day you choose, because it doesn't have to be Sunday. Vacuum, yeah, that's cleaning. So what are things we can do to celebrate? How do we celebrate things?
A party.
Decorations.
Balloons.
What, Teddy? special meal, maybe. Food helps us celebrate, right? We could have friends over, yeah? Friends and family. Cake. Why not? And then what are things we can do to help connect? For what? Connecting or celebrating? Because I think it goes for both. Music, for sure. But music, I think, can help us connect with each other. And this also means connect with God. So that's why we can't just sit on the couch and watch TV all day. Because that doesn't really help connect us with God.
It helps us connect.
As nice, it's relaxing, and maybe it's a fun thing to do, but we have to have a little bit of time for God on our Sabbath day. So what other ways can we connect? You mentioned games, playing games together. What were you going to say, Teddy? Not video games, playing games with somebody.
A board game?
Yeah, like, yeah, right. What else were you going to say? How can we connect?
Four.
Yeah. What, Chloe? What? Sleepover? Have friends? How can we connect with God on a Sunday? How do we connect with God on a Sunday? Where are you right now? Oh, you can go to church! And pray, and maybe you can read your Bible. Yeah, praise God. I think going for a walk helps me connect.
With a dog.
Yeah. The dog, definitely. So these are the three C's that we need to do one day every week. We gotta cease, and we gotta celebrate, and we gotta connect. And we're not always gonna get it perfect. Some days we might end up doing some work on our Sabbath day, but God will forgive us. And really, God's not upset about it. We don't offend God. God gave us this day for ourselves because God knows we need to cease and celebrate and connect because it helps bring us healing. Just like that lady in the Bible who Jesus healed in that story, we have to make the time to go seek Jesus out just like she did. And we will find exactly what we need. So try it today. Try ceasing. Try connecting, try celebrating with your family and remind your parents and grandparents and the grown-ups in your life about the three C's. So let's work on connecting right now because we're going to connect with God in a prayer. Are we ready? Okay, let's pray. God, thank you for giving us this great gift of a day to cease and celebrate and connect with you. We pray that you help us, remind us, and help us go easy on ourselves when it's not necessarily perfect. We pray your blessing on these children, that you would keep them safe and bring them back next week to learn more about you. And all of God's children said, amen. Eloise Westcott is the head of the Friendship Tree, which is the organization here in Whitney Point that does a lot of great things for our community, specifically the Backpack Program that gives kids, whoever signs up, exactly the school supplies they need in a brand new backpack for the class and the teacher list just for them. So this is unlike any other program I know of. Rather than just handing a bunch of random stuff out to kids, we make sure they have exactly what they need. And we also provide haircuts and school pictures and a lunch on that day. And so, of course, this takes some funds.
Yes, it does.
To make sure we can do all of this great stuff. So Eloise is going to tell us about a way we can help.
Good morning. Thank you for, excuse me, I have a frog in my throat today. Thank you for inviting me to share with you an exciting event being held right here in our own community. The Strides for School Supplies Color Fund 2018. You're probably asking yourself.
I play the band.
There you go. The Strides for School Supply Color Fun event is going to be held on Saturday, July 14th. Check-in time is going to be 8 a.m. The walk will actually begin at 9 a.m. It's going to be held the morning prior to the Whitney Point block party. Okay, that's held on Main Street here in Whitney Point, which will begin at 11 a.m. Our walk will be done by this time so that you'll be able to go and enjoy the other festivities of the day. You're probably asking yourself, what is a color fun? Well, have you heard of color run? Color runs, okay. Well, I can't call it color run because it's trademark. So I call it color fun. It's an exciting way for us to invite individuals and families to walk and share memorable moments together. A way to laugh, talk, and have fun with each other, and a way to enjoy each other's company. We'll have music this year at the starting point of the walk, and we'll be throwing color powder, which is used at Color Run events nationwide. It's all certified, non-toxic, and free of heavy metals. The bright colors are a combination of nothing more than cornstarch, baking soda, and colored dyes, all FDA approved. People may dress and get crazy in their get-ups, but you can just come in jeans, shorts, capris, I don't care, tights, tutus, whatever you want. You'll see some crazy get-ups. But I want you to just come, have fun, and enjoy the event. We encourage everyone to register before. I have forms with me today, and if you're computer savvy, you can go online and register online by going to the Whitney Point Friendship Tree site. There's a link there. It'll take you right in. Yeah. Blessing to Elaine. She set it all up for me. Thank you very much. I could not have done that. We also have sponsor cards, which we're asking individuals to go out and get additional sponsors, which will give us additional money that you can turn in the day of the event. That's very important to us. We've tried to keep our fees very low so that we can get people to participate. So sponsor cards with additional sponsors are very important to us also. Fees are $10 for an individual. How much cheaper can you get? Or if you're a family of four, you can register for $30. All proceeds will benefit the annual backpack program, which most of you are very well aware that have provided over 200 plus new backpacks and new school supplies for students entering the school year last year here in our own district. Last year, the program ran out of funds, and I truly just did not know what to do. It's very tough for an organization such as myself and just five other people to raise between $8,000 and $10,000 a year. We've been fortunate over the past year to have a corporate sponsor group who has unfortunately left us after 3 years. But hey, we only planned on it for 1 year, so 3 years was a blessing to us, believe me. However, I just want to say, when I put my little plea out on Facebook saying, I don't know what I'm going to do, if I can't raise the funds, I'm going to have to shut it down, and that would kill me. And it was this church who stepped up first, I think. So, I hope to see you all on July 14th, and I hope you encourage your family, friends, and neighbors to come and join us. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ellie. And it's just a nice walk. It's only a three-something miles.
Yeah, it's five laps.
Five laps around town. Nice morning. It's great. So if there's any teams that want to form in the church, or if you don't think you'll be able to walk, definitely just fill out a sponsor card for anybody. And there's all the forms are out on the table right as you walk out in the library right in front of the windows. And This is just another fundraiser in addition to the guitar raffle that we are in process of doing as well. So on that same day at the block party, we'll be drawing the winner of that custom Ledoux guitar that we got to see a few weeks ago. So if you want tickets to sell for that, or you want to buy some tickets, just let me know, and we will make sure that we're all working on these various fun opportunities to support students in our community. I'd ask you to please pray for me now as I pray for you. Let us pray. God of life, make your truth known today and forever, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, last week we dove right into a series on Sabbath, and we heard a scripture last week where Jesus chided the Pharisees who were being too legalistic about the Sabbath. And he reminded them, and us, of course, that the Sabbath was made for us to enjoy. It's a gift from God. It's not an obligation or a rule to follow. And I really believe that sharing this practice of Sabbath, a day of rest, sharing this with the world and teaching people how to do it, this is perhaps the greatest gift that the church can give to our world today, in our culture of being over busy, overbooked, hyper connected all the time. This is, I think, how the church can remain relevant in our world, is providing something that nobody else does. Now, in September, I began attending sessions for the Leadership Academy that is offered by the Upper New York United Methodist Conference. And I went expecting, of course, to learn about best practices and how to lead a church. But to my surprise, our first whole session, 2.5 days, focused on the topic of Sabbath. That's how important the leaders of our conference see Sabbath, that people wanting to learn how to be good leaders need to first learn how to rest and how to connect with God. And our guest lecturer that session was Reverend Lynn Babb, who wrote this lovely book called Sabbath Keeping. If you'd like to borrow it, just let me know. She told us about how she initially fell in love with keeping the Sabbath. She said she never was really aware of keeping the Sabbath as a practice until she and her husband lived in Israel for 3 years. And so the city they were in every week would just shut down for 24 hours. The buses stopped, all the stores closed. And this was before the internet, and they didn't have TV, and they didn't have a car, so they figured we better embrace this idea of Sabbath, or we're just going to be, you know, bored and grumpy for a day every week. So that's what they did. They embraced it, and they learned this rhythm of life, of taking a whole 24 hours just to be. But she said it wasn't until they moved back to the U.S. that they realized how beneficial this way of life really had been for their bodies and their souls. And so Pastor Lynn writes in her book, "We decided we'd continue to eliminate options one day a week, even if the American culture didn't eliminate them for us." What a great way of thinking about Sabbath. Eliminating options for one day a week. She said, we decided to use Sunday as our Sabbath day. And so we begin with worship at church, and then we went and did the kinds of things we were used to doing in Israel. Take a walk, read, play with our son, get together with friends. My husband decided not to prepare for work on Sundays. And we would try to do house projects and repairs and errands on Saturdays in order to keep Sunday free from work. She said we'd refrain from shopping on Sundays, both to limit our options and to help prevent others from having to work on Sundays too. We tried not to do any housework or household chores on Sundays. However, she says, I did cook because she loves to cook and she wanted to have friends over for meals. In the beginning, she said they didn't really know anyone else who was trying to practice the Sabbath in any kind of intentional way. But since then, interest has grown around this topic. There are many books written about it. And she kind of became a local expert in her church. And so in the book, she shares an interaction she had with a friend of hers as they were leaving church one Sunday. Her friend asked her what she thought about doing a hobby on Sundays, if that would be an okay Sabbath activity. And her friend was talking about scrapbooking. And Reverend Babb's response to her friend is just the perfect advice for all of us. She said, as long as it stays relaxing, it's fine. As soon as scrapbooking becomes work or something you absolutely have to get done on a deadline, then you should probably stop doing it on Sundays. Make sure whatever you do is a satisfying thing to do. As soon as something becomes compulsive, as soon as we're doing it because we want to get it done, or we think we have to get it done, then we need to stop doing it on the Sabbath. God has given us this day to rest, a day of just space, to leave behind our duties, our obligations, and to seek out God. Today, in our Bible reading, we heard about Jesus healing a woman on the Sabbath. And again, the religious leaders freak out about he's doing work on the Sabbath. But Jesus reminds them and us that receiving God's healing is exactly what the Sabbath is all about. We are instructed to cease from our obligations and work for 24 hours in order to receive God's healing. When we just linger in the richness and the joy of life, we are lingering with God. And it's in that lingering, in that presence, that we find healing and wholeness. In my psychology classes in college, we learned that contrary to what most students think, it's actually not beneficial to stay up all night and study before a test. If you don't give your brain the time it needs to sort all the information in there and to make the synaptic connections, you'll never be able to recall any of the stuff you studied. It's far better to go over the most important things and give your brain the 8 hours of rest it needs to organize and store all the information. A lot happens to our bodies when we sleep. And it's the same with Sabbath. A lot happens for our souls when we rest. It might seem like we're doing nothing. There's a lot going on. It's a time for reordering and reconnecting for our souls. So whether we're talking about a good night's sleep or a Sabbath day of rest, we know these things don't just happen by accident, right? We have to create time and space for Sabbath. We have to curate our schedules and homes to allow Sabbath to happen. The woman who Jesus healed on the Sabbath didn't just accidentally bump into Christ on her way to the market. She had to go to the synagogue. She had to seek him out. She had to plan to be away from home that day, to put some things off. She had to pack a snack, make the trip through town to the synagogue. When she was there, she had to sit at Jesus' feet and listen to him. She had to be paying attention and aware enough to hear Jesus call her forward. And when she heard Jesus calling, she had to get up and go to him. And when she did, when she was able to get up and go, she received the healing she had been waiting for 18 years. That's the good news for us about Sabbath. She had to make the time and space for Jesus, but when she did, he was there giving exactly what she needed. And that is the same for us. When we are able to make the time and space for God, we will be given exactly what we need. So what do we do? How do we do this? You should have seen me there at my Leadership Academy. I was taking notes and asking questions. I wanted the formula. How do I Sabbath? Tell me. Well, in her book, Pastor Lynn shares a variety of suggestions, but no formula. Because we're all different, right? And she even says in the book, I give these suggestions with fear and trembling. Because if they create in you a sense of obligation, then I will have defeated the very purpose of the Sabbath. If all these various possibilities I offer, going to worship, lighting a candle, festive meals, praying, walking, special games, if any of that becomes one more way for you to feel successful or productive, or it adds another burden for you to carry, then the spirit of Sabbath will be violated. And she adds, as you read these suggestions for activities to do on the Sabbath, pick one or two to start. Three at the most. And try them out for 3 months or 6 months. Then perhaps add something else in. Experiment lightly and be gentle with yourself. The Sabbath is about resting in God. It's not about feeling obligated to do something more. So last week I encouraged us all to start exploring what things help quiet our minds, what things help open our hearts to God's presence. If you are able to identify anything that helped you in that way this week, put that on the list. And now we need to pick a day, right? Most of us who are here probably works to have Sunday as our Sabbath day. But for some people, it doesn't. Or maybe every other week it works, but on alternating weeks, you have to choose a different day. And also, decide on a start time, because it's not just the day. It's a 24-hour period. So maybe think about Saturday night. How can you begin your Sabbath? What can you do to mark the start of this day of being in presence and resting in God? For me, I set my auto response on my email. That feels like a very satisfying ritual, spiritual practice. On Sunday nights, I set my away message, and then I can rest easy on my Sabbath Mondays, knowing that people will get a response right away that tells them I'll get back to them on Tuesday. In the Jewish tradition, they light two candles and say a prayer and have a big meal. Pastor Lynn says Saturday nights, she simply lights a candle. in the middle of the house on the dining room table or somewhere that you might pass by it often. And she says she leaves it lit for the whole 24 hours while they're awake and in the house, just as a reminder. And every time you see it burning, to remind yourself it's okay to linger. And we are in the space of Sabbath. She also says that I attempt to start the day in a way that differs from my normal morning routine. On the Sabbath, I wake up slowly and spend time just lying in bed, staring into space, luxuriating in the fact that I don't have to produce anything for a whole day. And I try to spend the whole day attuned to beauty, engaging my senses. And she also quotes Don Pastima, who says, good Sabbath keeping includes both praying and playing. Prayer without play can degenerate into a dutiful, cheerless religion. But play without prayer can become a mind-numbing escape. And this was a really important key to Sabbathing for me, that it's not just a mindless escape from reality. That unfortunately, sitting on the couch, binge-watching a show for 8 hours is not really Sabbath. Maybe one or two shows, sure. But I know I've got to remember to balance the play with prayer. There has to be some time for thought and awareness of God. In her book, Pastor Lynn shared that a rabbi she knew said his congregation wanted specifics. What were they allowed to do and what shouldn't they do on the Sabbath? So he used these three questions to help them determine whether an activity was suitable. One, does it promote rest or relaxation? Two, does it bring delight and enjoyment? And three, does it give you a sense of holiness and sanctity? In other words, does it add to your sense of Sabbath? So maybe sitting on the couch all day watching TV is maybe the first two, but certainly doesn't check the third box. Not that everything we do on Sabbath has to feel holy, but there has to be time for some of those activities. As I continue to work on practicing Sabbath, I know for myself that disconnecting from all my tech is a key to relaxing and delighting and feeling a sense of Sabbath. So I try not to use my computer at all. I turn on that email response. But I often, I admit, I find myself reaching for my phone a lot on my Sabbath days. And so I'm working on putting it away somewhere, turning it off, signing out of Facebook. And I found the things that help quiet my mind and open my heart to God's presence are things like going for walks, doing yoga, playing guitar, playing with Wade. And all of those things can't be done while you're on a device, while you're connected. This true relaxation and restoration on the Sabbath will require some preparation. Cook some extra food Saturday. Go grocery shopping another day of the week. Make a plan. Pick a Sabbath day and choose just one or two things to make it special. Light a candle. Set some boundaries for yourself. What won't you do or try not to do? Like checking email or going shopping. Make a plan, prepare, invite people over to connect. Keep the spirit of Sabbath in mind, knowing that grace abounds for us. If there's anything I've learned from working on Sabbathing, it's that I've got to go easy on myself. This concept is so countercultural that it takes a long time to learn this new rhythm of life. It takes practice. So let's practice. Because as we learn to Sabbath, it will get easier. And as we make this time and space for God in our lives, I know we are promised that we will receive the renewal and healing, the joy and peace that only God can give. Amen.
At the harvest of the Lord.